Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get it on. Mandate, get it on. Very excited because we're doing another one of our Dane Date shows. You people seem to enjoy so much. Wednesday, the 19th, we have Teresa Strasser doing the news. Bald Brian is here to give us an update and hang with us and jump in on the news. And before we get to the news, let's just see how everyone's health is. Brian, how are you feeling?
Actually, pretty good this week. Last week was chemo week, so I actually did it. Five days worth of pills, 400 milligrams a day of chemotherapy, and it was tough, man. It was maybe sleepy and tired and all those things, and I feel better. Last one was Friday, so I've been off pills since Friday, and feel better.
Good. Yeah. Now, I don't know if you heard about it, but I kind of got into it with Engineer Anderson doing Loveline last week. If you caught wind of that horrible argument I had with him on the air.
What happened?
Well, what happened was I was giving out your website.
Thank you, by the way. Thank you because the listeners have been very generous. And
you mean an inconvenienttumor.com?
No.
HiBrian.com.
Oh. HiBrian.com.
Yes, both.
B-R-Y.
As in why.
As in why. That's how I spell it. B-R-Y-A-N.
That was big, 78.
I was giving your website out, and Anderson kept interrupting, and then he kept calling you a brown noser, and basically said you're a world class ass kisser.
True.
And then kept saying that you owed him $150 every time I would give the website out and say please give generously, and then at a certain point I'd reach my saturation level. And so we just started arguing on the air for about 15 minutes. And then eventually...
I heard Dave involved.
David Alan Greer eventually got up and left.
Really?
Yeah, in the middle of the show. Well, not the middle of the show, in the middle of the argument, which was toward the end of the show. I couldn't figure out why this guy was arguing with me when I was trying to give out your website and raise some money. And I couldn't stand the label of brown noser. For Brian Bishop, I look at you as anything but a brown noser.
I feel like I've done a fair amount of disagreeing with you over the years. Mm-hmm.
I would say on the air and off the air, take music, for example. Right. I don't think I've ever gotten you to come around on any of my musical proclamations and vice versa.
I respect your opinions.
Yes, even if you don't value them.
True.
The point is...
Right before I dismiss them, I respect them briefly.
I kept saying he's not a brown noser. He argues with me about quite a few things quite often.
Yeah.
And I did not like the idea that he was labeling you a brown noser, but I was really just angry that he was arguing with me when I was trying to give out your goddamn website.
Timing seems really douchey, especially because I thought you guys were friends.
I say, full disclosure, Anderson and I are good friends. We actually went out on Friday and saw District 9 on opening day.
How was it?
He liked it better than I did.
Okay.
I thought it was only okay. I gave it a B-.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're such a brown noser, you would disagree with...
Wait a minute.
But generally good. But yes, you guys are friends.
Yes.
So I'm not sure why he just kept calling you an ass kisser.
Anderson
and a
loves
noser.
To aggravate.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's a pot stir.
Yes.
Yes. I'd like someone to hit him with a fucking pot on his fucking head. It's driving me nuts.
I'd rather be a brown noser than a pot stir.
Well, also, just this idea, and again, maybe it's a sore subject for me, but I just can't stand that. You know, well, if you disagree with Adam, you're out.
Right.
Which, of course, my answer to that with Anderson is you would have fucking been fired the first fucking 5 minutes I fucking met you, you asshole. So, of course, you don't have to kiss my ass because you're living proof.
Meanwhile,
you don't have to kiss my ass.
He is Loveline's longest-running employee.
He's been there for 10 years, and I would have fired him the first fucking week I worked with him because he's such a douche. So, of course, you don't need to kiss my ass. You're sitting here. You're proof positive you don't need to kiss my ass. And by the way, nobody in that entire building ever kissed me or Drew's ass for the entire, 11 years I was there.
Just imagine, T, that Anderson and I are very, very polar opposite people. I mean, I think myself is pretty positive and fun-loving. Anderson is angry and likes to be a shit stirrer.
He's a button pusher, yeah. Too. Yeah. And I think he would mistake Brian. That the whole thing is Loveline, for all those years, was not very professional. And thus, you know, as I've told you many times, you would, you know, I would have my hash settled by the phone screener. I would have junior producer Lauren come in and insult me. And basically everyone there should have been fired 1,000 times. And Brian was sort of the only one who actually just was sort of courteous and thus maybe got labeled with the ass kisser.
Sure.
But then he told me you were fired from Love Line, which I forgot about. I said, Brian was fired from Love Line?
My time had come. And I was asked to leave.
Why were you asked to leave?
I was actually on my way out anyway at the time. My time had expired. But I was asked to write a blog by a fan and just sort of detailing what was on the background. And I was detailing what was on the background, and I was complaining about Drew and Adam and the producers. And then one day they were like, you can't write this anymore. Maybe your time here is coming.
Wait a second now. You see, now I should have used this for that
right.
Douchebag Anderson, which is he said you got fired for writing shit about Drew.
But did you write about Adam?
Oh, yeah, both. Everything
right.
Goes on behind
so
the scenes.
Obviously that asshole conveniently left out the part where you're writing shit about me because it would have crapped all over his
and by the way,
ass-kissing.
Yeah, if
argument.
You looked at it now in retrospect, it's very tame. Very tame.
I'm sure, but the whole idea that he's saying you're a brown noser
right.
And then saying you got fired from Loveline, so how good an employee could you have been? But you got fired from Loveline for writing shit about me, the guy you're supposed to be brown nosing, nullifies your brown nose argument, right?
All I know is this is very upsetting because, Adam, I've rarely seen you as upset because I saw you the next day after this battle with Anderson. And before we sat down to do the podcast, I asked how you were doing, and you said, I'm emotionally drained. And then I thought, I don't know this Anderson, but now I don't like him.
Well, I was drained because I wanted to send people to your website. I wanted to raise money for you. And I just couldn't believe I was arguing with somebody about that process.
The timing is just so strange. Like, I'm trying to give out this website so people can donate because he's fighting cancer.
Anderson is obviously an asshole, but he's a liar. And that's the main thing. I don't mind him being an asshole. I have no problem with that. There's plenty of assholes out there. But he's lying, and I guess the fact he conveniently left out the part where you were talking shit about me as well as Drew is the part that makes him a liar.
Yeah, Brian, that's unlike you. I can't imagine you blogging and thinking that no one was going to find it.
I wasn't concerned. I wasn't really.
I didn't give a shit.
I wasn't
by the
really
way.
Concerned at the time because A, it was very innocuous. It was
right.
Fairly innocuous, and B, it was a fan of the show who said, "Would you mind just running up behind his blog for my site?"
Well, we
sure.
just found it. The Loveline Companion, Brian's
yep.
blog.
Well, maybe we can read that. T, get up on your feet. I know you're 19 months right there.
I'm in my sixth trimester.
But let's see what Brian actually said to get him relieved.
I'm sure one of the last ones.
Oh, we never found it, by the way. So it's not up there?
Fairly innocuous.
Oh, and you wrote a little goodbye. It's been an amazing and memorable 3 years. I've made lifelong friends, met incredibly cool celebrities, and got to work alongside two of the most talented people. Oh, that is brown nosy. Two of the most talented people in show business, Adam and Drew.
You got shit canned
yeah.
for talking smack.
Oh, yeah.
Throughout it all, I always felt like a fan who just got lucky. That's really sweet.
All right, so you
I didn't
you
know
got,
you did Jew or Asian.
You
that
got,
sounds fun.
You got fired for talking shit about me and or Drew. On a blog.
Sort of. I mean,
sort of.
We should go back and read them because they're very innocent.
But the point is enough to someone to make a case to
yes.
let you go.
It nullifies the bread noser argument.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It flies
yes.
in the face of the bread noser argument.
Right. All right.
And
well,
by the
there
way,
you go.
Funny coincidence.
Oh, wait a minute. Maybe we do. Maybe
funny
now
coincidence.
We do have it. Yes.
Anderson, for the day, that day, had to come back from cancer camp. He volunteers.
I know.
He's a conundrum.
He's a retarded Rubik's Cube. He's a Rubik's Cube of shit.
He's twisted.
Yes.
Oh, this is interesting. See, you gave away a little bit of inside scoop here. Red Letter Day in Loveline history. Drew and Adam asked for a male caller. This is literally in bold. The first time I've been asked to get a male caller compared with dozens of times I've been asked, told, no more guys tonight. This is usually uttered 10 minutes into the show, by the way.
That's interesting.
All right.
Interesting.
Wow.
All right, you gave away inside secrets.
I would have never fired you, buddy. You know me.
I realize that.
I didn't read blogs.
Because you were too busy reading all those books.
Yeah, the square things with the pages. All right, T-Bone.
Yeah.
Let's hear some news.
This is exciting. I'm glad you're here, Brian. Because this is courtesy of Mike Lynch, former Adam Carolla show writer Mike Lynch, who sent this along. It could be one of the best, definitely not a Jews ever.
Wow.
It's just that good.
I'm poised.
Okay. What happens when you're living in Florida, you're very hungry, you work at a restaurant, you're possibly on meth. I'll show you the lady's picture. She has kind of a meth face, but it's unclear what drug she's on.
Sunken cheek eyes.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, kind of fried blonde hair. This woman, Luann McKinley, Luann McKinley of Stuart, Florida, was working at a Perkins restaurant, and she stole some bacon. Mm-hmm. And by some, I mean 3 pounds. Mm-hmm. A coworker turned...
Raw or cooked?
Does not say, but I'm guessing cooked.
Never know.
You couldn't transport 3 pounds of cooked bacon. Right. You'd need a steak bed truck. I mean, once it's cooked, it really doesn't weigh anything. I mean, you would need a pallet jacket. 3 pounds of cooked bacon is a barrel full of bacon. Yeah, it's a lot of bacon. So it doesn't stack evenly either.
No, this is good because I'm a vegetarian, so I'm not good with the meat.
Pre-cooking weight.
So right. She takes the 3 pounds of bacon from the Perkins restaurant where she... used to work. I imagine she's been let go. She stuffed it in her purse, and then a coworker reported the theft, and the police tracked her down. They looked in her bag. Sure enough, 3 pounds of bacon and drugs.
No.
So now she faces charges on drug and theft.
Journey.
By the way, that's a gold mine for the canine dog. Normally just smelling junkies and getting stabbed with syringes and sniffing out TNT at the airport.
Look what I found.
Finally, somebody's put some fucking bacon in a purse. It's usually, it's a bunch of methamphetamine. Like the stories that canine shepherd was told. Hello, as he was walking back into the kennel. Hello, doing a thing with his paws where he was holding it over his head. Yes. Hey, Bob, what were you sniffing today? A hobo's ass? Interesting. Let me tell you what I just sniffed. Bacon. 3 pounds of bacon. And then there must be that conversation when they're bringing the bacon back to the, you know, they have to put it in the evidence room.
Yep.
And
right.
Then there's the bad German shepherd, and he's like, what if that bacon got lost somewhere between here and the evidence room?
2 pounds.
Yeah.
That's right. It's going to go bad.
Yeah. No one's here to find it. And then the dog has a scheme where he needs the bacon. He's talking to his captain. He needs to take the bacon back out. How are we going to catch more junkies without bacon, Cappy?
That's how we catch them.
You got to trust me, that bacon. And then the captain does a thing. The captain's like a schnauzer. And the captain's like, listen. If that bacon, he's a black lab. Yeah. He's a fat black lab.
Yeah.
And he's like, listen to me. If so much as one strip of that bacon is missing, when it comes back, it's going to be your ass.
And then you're going on corpse duty.
I'll lift your collar. That's right. You'll be sniffing out corpses in New Orleans.
Leave your collar on the desk.
I like how this went from a definitely not a Jew to a really decent animated movie.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so of course he takes the bacon out. He sets up the deal. It's a chihuahua who's the front man. And he loses the bacon and has to come back and deal with the huge fat black lab who's screaming, shut the door!
He says to the younger partner, his new younger partner, wow, 2.5 pounds of bacon, 2.5 pounds. I thought it was 3 pounds. 2.5 pounds.
Or maybe 2 pounds.
So she steals the 3 pounds of bacon.
Yeah.
So again, you know, street value on that's got to be, you know, $18, $20. And she's going to go home and listen. First off, maybe this was just to shut her husband up. Like, okay, you wanted me to bring home the... There's your fucking bacon.
Is that enough for you?
That's enough fucking bacon? You've been yelling at me to bring home the goddamn bacon since we've been married. Here's your goddamn bacon. I hope you choke on it. Maybe she was literally...
Not another word of the bacon.
I would argue, if she has a decent attorney, that attorney would say, look, my client is high on drugs, and her husband yelled, you've got to start bringing home the bacon or I'll beat this. You know, so she feared for her life. And she was high, so she was a literalist, and she literally brought home the bacon.
Interesting legal strategy. My client is high on drugs.
Right, exactly. Sometimes that works. Sometimes that works. Or if you know, sometimes you get confused. Like after you make the cereal, you put the milk in the cabinet, you put the cereal in the refrigerator. I mean, if this woman were high when she got home with the bacon and the meth, she'd have accidentally snorted
by
the
way, they foiled this plan early.
An MLT.
Because the following day, she would have tried to get out there with 40 head of lettuce and then 1,500 tomato to make the largest BLT. That was her dream. Her dream was to build the largest BLT in Florida. And it was nipped in the bud.
Well, I knew you'd be happy to know that things are just as fucked up in Florida as they've ever been.
Yeah.
All right. Awesome. Well, it's been a couple days, but I thought it'd be worth discussing with you guys the new crop of stars on Dancing with the Stars.
Oh, I've been out of the loop.
Here's a phrase I never thought I would say. Dame Elizabeth Taylor has been tweeting, but she has. She has a favorite of the dance. Liz Taylor. Yeah.
She got a dame?
Yeah, I guess she's a dame.
Makes sense.
All right.
She's got a favorite of the new crop.
Mm-hmm.
And her favorite is model Kathy Ireland.
No way.
According to her Twitter feed, I'm so excited to see Kathy Ireland on Dancing with the Stars. She is so beautiful. She added, to watch her in movement will be a golden chance to see beauty in action and grace, which is what that lady is all about.
Really?
Yes.
She was a swimsuit model in the like 90s or 80s, 90s.
Action star.
And she did a shitty football movie, Necessary Roughness, where she plays a kicker who waddles up to the ball and barely strikes it with the right foot. And then, of course, they cut to the ball sailing through the goalpost. Yeah, at 50 yards. As far as I know, a horrible actress. And then I guess designs furniture or something, but I think it's one of those things where she just puts her name on an end table or something.
Sure. Yeah. Here one.
But either way, why the fuck is Liz Taylor pulling for?
Very bizarre. Also taking to his Twitter feed is former Republican Congressman Tom DeLay, saying, "I think you'll be impressed by my moves."
Oh, he's dancing. So who's the roster?
Okay, you got Melissa Joan Hart, the actress.
Sabrina,
exactly. Right. As for the athletes...
Never hot, by the way. On my list of never hot that people thought were hot.
She's going to do very well in the Jenny Garth mode, though, because she's a mom and she had to lose the baby weight and then she was on the cover of People. Michael Irvin.
Ooh
Michael strong.
Irvin.
Strong. Yeah.
Former Dallas Cowboy.
Sure.
Ashley Hamilton.
Who's that?
Well, that's a good question. He is...
Oh, George Hamilton's
Yes,
kid?
And he was married to Shannon Doherty briefly. Now, they list him...
Oh, he's likable.
And they list him as actor... You're going to get pissed. Actor, singer, songwriter, comedian.
Well, comedian in that we're making fun of his singing and songwriting.
There you go.
I mean, when you're laughing at a guy's song, then that does kind of make you a comedian and... Look, when everyone in McCabe's has burst out in laughter after your acoustic set, that does kind of make you a comedian songwriter.
If you inspire laughter, you are there for a reason.
He probably gets more laughs than a lot of, open micers at Yuck Yucks.
Absolutely.
Debbie Mazar, who you know from Entourage.
Sure.
Aaron Carter, singer.
Aaron Carter, that guy.
He's a kid, blonde kid.
Yeah, he pissed me off.
The younger brother's a Backstreet Boy.
Yeah.
What do you do?
Well, he nailed a lot of hot young ass, and he made me mad. I found him to be greasy and very Floridian. The whole Carters, by the way, that's everything that's wrong. I bet they all have bacon in their purses.
All the boy bands feel like they have bacon
start,
in their purses.
And they'll start in Florida, and everything is very, and he's very greasy, and he's just, ugh. It seems like a zero.
Louis Vito. Do you know who that guy is?
No.
He's a snowboarder.
Oh, of course.
Donny Osmond.
Also a snowboarder.
Who's going to do very well.
Yeah.
You'll remember his sister was on. She fainted.
Sure.
A singer named Maya. And then someone Maya. We all know, Chuck Liddell.
Wow.
Who I thought
funny.
He was so nice when he was on our show.
Chuck's a nice guy, but Chuck's kind of a madman, and Chuck likes to booze it up and party and hit it pretty good. So we shall definitely see. That'll be interesting because a guy obviously an athlete, but will it transfer? We'll see.
More of a striker than a grappler. That's
yeah.
all I remember
yeah.
from my Chuck Liddell interviews.
I would Chuck's going to be fun and. You know the better list? The better list are the people who passed.
Right.
They wanted a politician, and obviously Tom DeLay was not their first choice. I think Bill Clinton was their first choice.
Oh, sure.
Oh, they have a long list. They'd rather have Ted Kennedy than Tom DeLay.
Gingrich.
Right. Also Macy Gray.
Oh, really?
And swimmer Natalie Coughlin.
Macy Gray, I love her voice. She seems nutty.
Yep.
She does seem a little nutty.
It's going to be interesting to see how that one works out.
No one's as nutty as Mindy McCready.
Love Mindy McCready.
She's a country singer, right?
Yeah, Brian's a big fan. We were always doing Mindy McCready stories, and I thought, well, maybe we've heard the last of Mindy McCready.
You and I are both big fans, but for different reasons. I actually like her music, and you love her
I like her lifestyle, yeah.
And we don't know if Brian's actually a fan of country music or he's just agreeing with me when I talk about how much
I
love country
right.
music.
Brown nosing with
Never
you.
Stop talking about my love of country music and who knows what Brian really
You
likes.
Me, boss. You me.
Well, let me just hit on a couple of Mindy McCready's highlights. Let's see. She was arrested and charged with attempted murder after beating and choking. Oh, no, that was her ex. He was arrested after beating and choking her. Oh, that's horrible. She was found unconscious in a hotel in Florida after attempting suicide.
Florida?
Yeah. Why would you try to kill yourself there? She was hospitalized for a drug overdose after washing down a large amount of undisclosed drugs with alcohol. Then she was pregnant with that guy who tried to kill her. She attempted to kill herself for a second time by overdosing on antidepressants. Then in 2008, paramedics were called to her home in Nashville after another suicide attempt. They transported her to the hospital. Anyway, where does she end up? She ends up in celebrity rehab.
Nice.
Best possible
oh, really?
Place.
Well, now, Brian, you say she's a good artist.
She was. She had a strong debut album back in like 97. And then it all fell apart. So this is related, obviously.
She does have a really good voice. And obviously, some soulfulness to put into her music.
Like I said, one great album back in 97.
Yeah, I talked to Dr. Drew, actually, yesterday. An uncomfortable conversation with him, marginally, about... He said, well, it is actually about to get more uncomfortable when I say this in front of you guys. He said, well, we got to get together. We got to go to dinner. I said, I'm wide open. Whenever you guys want to get together, we'll get together. He said, how about this Friday? I said, that's no good. That's Lynette's throwing her birthday party. And then there was a pause.
Uh-oh.
And I said, I'll see you there. And he said, no, I was never invited.
Oh, no.
And I said, oh. And then I did the thing, the same thing I'm going to do with you guys, which is I farmed out everything. I just told her friends, just go invite whoever.
I've been invited.
You want to
so
invite? Far. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Oh, thank Christ.
Better or worse.
So, nice job, girls, not fucking inviting Dr. Drew.
Wow.
There was an oversight. And then Drew said, well, maybe he got invited, maybe it's his wife, and he was out of town on a cruise, so we'll figure it out. But it is
well, hopefully we'll see him on Friday.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I'm sure this was all a terrible oversight.
I'm sure, too.
Because we'll have to quiz him about,
this... Mindy McCready. Yeah, I mean, he says this thing's unbelievable. Actually, he says the sex addict one is going to be, like, off the charts.
Cannot wait for
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
All right, well, here's the latest. Eric Dane is an actor. You may know him. I think he's Mick Steamy
yes.
on Grey's.
Yeah.
And he's married to Rebecca Gayhart.
Yeah.
She's still around?
Well, yeah. She's making a comeback right now because this is a huge story. There's a sex tape.
Oh, no. She's got Yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead. She's got the same nickname Manny Pacquiao does.
Which is?
It'd be too cruel for me to really explain that joke. So anyone is just doing the math on the chick from the Noxzema commercial and Manny Pacquiao. That'll be one of that'll be our own quiet little joke that you can just go. You can go off and Google and you just Google her and then Google Manny Pacquiao's nickname. Not Pac-Man, by the way.
Not Pac-Man. Now, does this have to do with her unfortunate hit and run?
I'm not sure if she ran.
She hit.
I think she hit. And again, that wasn't... There's killed a young Latino child. But by the way, if you hit someone in L.A., they're going to be Mexican. So it's not like she's gunning for him. Right. I mean, if you're not in someone's living room. And then the second thing is I think the kid just... She was like on her cell phone and the kid just like ran out. In front of the
terrible car. Accident, obviously.
Horrible accident, and it definitely can't judge because could have happened to anyone, including us. We know and us, right? You're talking on a cell phone. The kid should have been supervised. Should have been like walked to school or something like that. I guess she was on her cell phone. I don't know if she was like rolling through a stop sign, but the kid like ran out in front of the car. Let's see.
Vehicular manslaughter.
Yeah. Ooh. 9-year-old Jorge Cruz Jr. He was jaywalking across the street in Los Angeles. And let's see. Child was walking home from school and ran across the street.
She faced criminal charges.
Yeah. There was a vehicle that was in front of Gayhart stopped. This is what happens. Okay. Here's what happens, and this is why it could have happened to me, and I got a ticket for this very thing in Santa Monica. Every asshole in the city is driving an SUV, and every other asshole is jaywalking, which I don't mind. Like, jaywalk all you want, just don't make the car stop to jaywalk. Like, stand around, wait for an opening, and then just you dart across the street like one of those little river mosquitoes. But what you don't do is go out in the street and get cars to stop for you. Because what happened to her, and it could happen to any of us, there's an SUV parked, and it stopped inexplicably in the middle of the street. And there's so many assholes in this town that don't know how to drive that if I came up on that guy too, I would just go around that guy, especially if there's two lanes. So she just goes around the guy, but what she can't see...
Is a kid
walking in front of the SUV. I almost killed somebody... On the way home from Dancing with the Stars, I did the same thing. I slingshotted into the right lane, and I was going to go right around this SUV at a signal right when it turned, and there was a couple of chicks just walking right and stepped right in front of me. I couldn't see them. Pedestrians way too goddamn casual in this city. And yes, use the crosswalk, or I don't care if you jaywalk, but don't do that thing where you walk out and then do that thing where you start conducting traffic. I don't say this kid did that. I'm just on a jag now. Where you walk out and you stand in the middle of Ventura Boulevard. Now you're going to wait and the car in front of you is going to stop for you. And it's like, oh, fucking just wait till it's open and run across.
Now, do I even want to know what Manny Pacquiao's nickname is? I know his dad killed and ate his dog. We learned that when we had his trainer on.
Yes. Yes.
That's something I'll never forget. Well, they
can go look for it.
I'll let you look it up.
It's too cruel.
Rebecca Gayhart and Eric Dane and this woman named Carrie Ann Paniche, who's a former beauty queen, teen beauty queen. There was a sex tape with all three of these people. Now, Eric Dane's folks would like you to know it's not a sex tape because you don't actually see sex. In this video, Gayhart says her alter ego name is Nina. Carrie, the dethroned teen queen, is Fifi. And Dane goes by several monikers: Peter, Cocaine Manor, Tristan Daly. Okay.
All right, but how about some fucking credit for putting those two together
that
as fast
nice.
As I did?
You did.
Manny Pacquiao is called the Mexicutioner. Because he takes out so many Mexican...
And that's
Mexican,
also what Gayhart is called
so many
by Mex- some.
So many Mexican fighters in the lighter weight division. Donnie. pardon me for blowing smoke. And by the way, if Brian really was a brown noser, he'd have it firmly up my ass right now.
That was my C+.
Thank you. Who else on the planet's going to do the Rebecca Gayhart Pacquiao nickname math? Especially when most of you know him as the Pac-Man.
Yes, impressive. Mm. Okay, so
back to this tape. So.
Yeah, there's a tape of the three of them, and they all have using their alter egos. Now, I'm going to get to this in a minute, but Mindy McCready is not a roommate you ever want to have. And
Depends.
Well, you don't want her near your hard drive. Okay, so Carrie Ann, this teen queen, had this video, allegedly, on her hard drive.
Oh, this is all tying into the Mindy McCready thing?
Yes. Mindy McCready ends up going on Celebrity Rehab with this teen beauty pageant girl, who's all Carrie Ann Panisch. They lived together after Celebrity Rehab. And I guess they had a falling out, so Mindy McCready allegedly stole this video off Carrie Ann's hard drive.
Now, how old is this?
Couple years old. Mm-hmm. And the two women are in a bathtub, and Eric Dane's taping them. He's calling action behind the camera. They're soaking. They're playing dress up. His people are saying there's no sex involved. It's just an innocent time in the tub.
But is it jackable? I mean, damn it.
I'm assuming it is, but I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
What isn't?
So he's married to her at this time, or at least going to get married to her at this time.
I think, those two have been
and
together for a while.
She's having fun with this ex-beauty queen.
Yeah, exactly. And then now Carrie Ann says she got in an argument with Mindy McCready over money and believes the singer took her hard drive when she moved out. Carrie Ann freaked out about certain personal information on the hard drive, probably this tape, and filed a stolen property report with the LAPD. So last month there was a summit between Eric, Rebecca, Carrie Ann, and Mindy. They hammered out a deal. And Eric got full rights to the video. Everyone assumed that was that, but the tape has surfaced on the internet.
What? Mindy McCready needs to be destroyed, like an animal that's sick. You know what I mean? Like,
just put
at
her
a certain
down.
Point, someone goes, look, not only for society, not only for your family, but for you. And whatever damage you may cause after this.
Well, season 3, Celebrity Rehab, proves to be, I mean, they got Mackenzie Phillips, Dennis Rodman.
Wow.
Tom Sizemore.
Strong.
Yeah.
Heidi Fleiss, whose dad is my pediatrician.
Really?
Yeah.
He's a pediatrician. Yeah, he's been out here for a million years.
Yeah.
I remember when I was a kid.
He's going to be fun. You got to get the pediatrician before you give birth to the kid.
I called Sizemore, by the way. But let me tell you. Can I tell you guys a problem that happens with celebrities? Celebrities don't leave outgoing messages that say, hi, this is Tom Sizemore.
Right.
You've reached my cell phone. You don't say, hey, this is Alec Baldwin. They never say that. They have the person, they'll have the, you know, built-in operator just going, you have reached this number. Leave a message. Okay. Now, the problem with that is when you get a celebrity number, they change the numbers a lot, and you're never quite sure, especially if you're Tom Sizemore. So Drew wanted me to call Tom Sizemore and talk to him about something. So I called Tom Sizemore, but I can't really leave Tom Sizemore a message going, hey, this is Adam Carolla. Call me at, because if that's not Tom Sizemore's number, then there's some 19-year-old kid who just has Adam Carolla's home phone number, and he's going to bug me now. I've had it happen. I told you I did it once, Josh Brolin, and it turned out I was calling a chick in Redlands. And I called her back. She's like, hey, you left the message. And then, hold on, Adam Carolla's on the I don't know. No. Hi, Adam.
I also want something.
Enjoyed you on Dance with the Stars. No, Josh Brolin doesn't live here. I'm overseeing her. She's a caretaker for a ranch. This is a problem. So all the celebrities don't leave their names on the thing, and they don't even leave their first name on the thing. And if someone says, hey, this is Alec Baldwin's number, or hey, this is Tom Sizemore, and you get the generic thing, don't you think maybe you didn't get the right number?
Right.
Hey, here's Robert Downey Jr.'s number. And then you call and you get the generic thing. Now you don't want to leave your number.
Right.
So anyway, I owe Tom Sizemore a call, but I don't want to leave my number because I don't know if that's his fucking thing or not.
Well, if he hears this, you should give Adam a call.
Mm-hmm.
Looking forward to that. All right, healthcare.
Now, so is that thing out on the internet, or where is it?
This sex tape has apparently surfaced on the internet, but I guess there's not any sex in it. There's just some bathtub scenes with Rebecca Gayhart and this teen queen.
Is there nudity involved with it?
You'd think so, right? Because, explicit content.
All right, well, we'll try to watch it and see what we can
get. See if it's,
Yeah. Yeah. I'm way behind. I still haven't even seen the Rob Lowe one.
Oh, you are behind.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I have not seen that. You know what I never saw and I'm kind of curious is the Kim Kardashian.
I never really saw, I saw like bits and pieces of it. I haven't seen the Rob Lowe. I'm way behind. I have no idea how it works because when you drive down Lancashire Boulevard and you pass the Odyssey video, in huge print on the window, it'll say, "We have the Paris Hilton tape here." How does that work?
That's someone's personal property, or was.
But how does that work with Paris Hilton? Does she not have attorneys? Yeah. Does she care? How does it work? Did they don't get a cease and desist? Is Paris in on it? I've asked this question for really 10 years now, and I've never really gotten a satisfactory answer.
Yeah, we asked a lawyer, and he didn't really explain it well.
Very murky. I'm
we're looking at part of this, and it looks like they're in... Oh, there's Eric Dane. It looks like they're just in some lingerie.
Yeah.
Although he doesn't seem to have his shirt on.
Yeah. And he doesn't engage them in sex?
Well, he has said that it's not a sex tape because there isn't, in fact, any sex on the tape.
Some people hear moral fiber. I hear small cock.
Yeah.
When a guy's doing the sex tape and he ain't whipping it out, he got nothing. Because you know those guys that look really good with their shirts off and their shirts flying off all the time?
Oh, wait a second.
Wait.
Uh-oh.
What did we see?
We
saw a little vaginal area?
Well, we saw his area. He's not wearing anything.
Oh, that's his area.
Well, it was covered by the gawker bug down there because we're watching on gawker.
Maybe he does have a big honker then.
Yeah, and definitely this looks like a three-way because, is that his wife or is that the teen queen? That's the teen queen. So, well, God bless them. They have a healthy sex life.
I'm sure the parents of the 9-year-old Mexican boy would love to see that, when she was giving the speech to the judge saying she'll never forget this and life will
she's
never go on.
She's going to dedicate her life
to helping others. She's having
community
a three-way
service
with McSteamy. All right. Well, again, look, I feel sorry for her. That could have happened to me 1,000 times over. But still, I definitely stand by my Manny Pacquiao joke. You know what I'd like to do? I'd like to do a bootleg sex tape where I was walking around, but they had the thing over my Pepe. You know, they had me tiled out.
Right.
But that thing was 3 feet long. And I would just release it that way. And it would literally be, it showed swinging around by my kneecaps.
Balls long.
And it would be funny at a certain point. Oh, Donnie, write this down. I turned the corner, knocked a lamp over that I was 3 feet from. And it was just the whole time was nothing but that thing.
You should have let it off.
All right, now we're seeing some nudity. Yeah,
you do see nudity. And sure, it's possible they don't engage in sex.
Right.
Just because they're nude in a tub.
Right.
Highly unlikely.
Right. All right, what other stories do we have?
Okay, so you've probably heard ad nauseum about the healthcare debate.
Sure.
The Obama administration is saying that it has not shifted its goals on healthcare reform or distanced itself from a government-run public insurance option. Now, here in our area locally, you probably know the Forum as a place to see the Lakers.
Sure.
Fabulous Forum.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Lakers used to play there. Well, yesterday wrapped up the largest free healthcare clinic in the nation. I don't know if you saw any of the news stories about this.
Yeah, I heard about this, yeah.
Oh, my. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Thousands of people were lining up at the Forum, some of them sleeping in their cars overnight, sleeping in the sidewalk, just to get a filling or glasses. They did thousands of fillings. They gave thousands of dental exams.
Wow.
They distributed over 1,000 pairs of glasses. They gave over 5,000 general medical exams.
When I'm in charge, by the way, I'm going to have these things nationwide. You know, free dental care, free health care. You know, if you need some ointment or some salve or you need a boil lanced and you don't have a physician, come on down. Everybody enter and we'll fill up the form. And at a certain point, I give the nod to my people and you see them shutting the doors and putting the shovels in between the two latches. And then I'm just up on the roof smoking a cigarette. And in slow motion, I flick it into the thing and a torch will go and you hear the screams. And I'm just like, I'm taking out the garbage here, people. I'm going to clean this city up. These were diseased vermin, and I just took care of them. Now moving to Santa Monica and cleaning up the parks. Awesome. Yeah, that's got to be it. That is a tough detail to pull. You know, working
that. You mean as like a dentist or an optometrist?
Yes. Because first off, imagine the breath on some of those people. You know what I mean? Oral hygiene is not at the top of their list.
No, low priority.
Very low priority.
Now, some of these people, though, are simply underinsured. They have insurance, but they don't have dental or vision.
I did the same. I used to go to the free clinics in, you know, Santa Monica and go to the county USC and do all that stuff. And, you know, I do think there's a way to do this. Well, first off, as far as insurance goes, here's my take on all this stuff. I don't know if I was yapping about this on the air or not, Weezer. You can yell if I was. But as far I would like this stuff treated like auto insurance, which is some sort of deductible that makes you not abuse the system. And then also think about auto insurance in general. You go to a guy to fix your fender, if the insurance is paying for it, he'll charge you $4,000 for it. Now, we all know it's two Mexicans, a can of Bondo in 2 days, and a couple cans of primer are going to fix this problem. And you can take it. I've had auto body estimates where, like, you go to the dealer and tell them the insurance is going to take care of it. It's like $6,000. Or you go down to Pepe's on the corner, and that guy will do it for $350. I mean, it is wild. And when you're not paying for it, you really don't give a shit. Like, I don't care if they charge $5,500 for a $700 job because I'm not paying the $5,500. Whenever you get into that situation where sort of someone else is paying, then you get the kind of abuse of the system. I'd love to work it out somewhere where we were able to lower the prices so that a Q-tip didn't cost $26. And then people were sort of counted on paying for their medicine, just like they pay for anything else in life.
Right. If it was a not-for-profit, say a public option, they might be less likely to charge you the $55 aspirin. And you might be more concerned about your medical costs if you were somehow more
right. We need a position where they can't charge $55 for an aspirin, and you are outraged because you're not going to pay $55 for an aspirin. We get to that point, we'll take care of a lot of this.
Anyway, it was just amazing seeing scenes of this because the group is called Remote Area Medical, and they generally open these clinics in Guyana, in India, in these incredibly impoverished countries, yet they couldn't even meet the needs of all the people who came out to the forum.
Well, Inglewood is a pretty good place. I mean, if they would have done this in Malibu, they probably would have had a slightly lighter turnout. But, yes, Inglewood is the cradle of the uninsured, especially here in Los Angeles.
City of champions.
And, Chick Hearn's rolling over in his grave.
Oh, poor Chick.
Funniest joke Magic Johnson ever told is when he was eulogizing him. And he was done with Chick Hearn's. He was doing Chick Hearn's. He was now bringing on Cardinal Mahoney, and he called him Colonel Mahoney. I don't know why I almost drove into a drainage ditch. I was driving my car, and he's like, now I'd like to bring out the Honorable Colonel Mahoney.
In God's Army?
Colonel Mahoney was awesome. And it was like much like the Michael Jackson video when he said, behold! Remember he was in that Michael Jackson Egyptian video?
Yes.
It's the greatest thing ever.
Oh, remember the time.
Behold! Somebody find that Michael Jackson. Doesn't matter if you're black or white.
Remember the time.
Oh, that was it?
Yep.
The whole Egyptian thing?
Yeah.
What was he saying?
There was a couple other celebrities in that.
Did he say remember the time in it?
Yes.
That was the chorus of the song, right?
Remember the time Magic Johnson mispronounced. Behold. Behold.
It's hard to forget the time.
Oh, if he could have married that somehow to Colonel Mahoney, would have been awesome. All right, sorry. Where were we?
We were talking about Brett Favre.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Well, by the time you're hearing this, something may have changed, but as it stands...
Hold on. Find that Michael Jackson video. Don't worry about Brett Favre. Sorry.
Screw you, Brett Favre. I guess he's going... As it looks like now, as we speak, this could change. It looks like he's going to be signing a contract with the Vikings.
He's officially annoying people and hurting his legacy now.
Yes.
Yeah.
What's the big fucking deal? Just play or don't play? Is this a press thing? Is he trying to get some extra money? Like, what's going on?
Well, it looks like he's going to be signing for $10 to $12 million for a one-year deal pending a physical.
How about he cut a deal for Just for Men and comb a little blonde into that goddamn gray beard of his? I don't know why, guy. I was talking about this on the NFL Network. The whole thing about sports is you get old and it's time to get out. And everyone talks about how old he is. He's a 40-year-old, you know, he's a 40-year-old quarterback and he doesn't have the legs or whatever. And he's not helping his cause by walking around with that 3 inches of gray or three-quarters of an inch of gray stubble on his chin. It's like his beard is pure white and he refuses to shave. And if Brett Favre shaved and tossed in a little Grecian formula, you'd have no... He'd really look like he'd look like 29.
Right.
But it's that gray beard. He insists... It's almost... He's almost mocking people with it. Anyway, Brett Favre is back. Who gives a shit?
I agree. Now, this on the heels of the Michael Vick story, which personally affected me, because, as you guys know, my husband is from Philadelphia.
Right.
And what happened was, I was taking a bath... I'll make it brief, but I was taking a bath and I made a critical error.
Oh,
I could usually get out of the tub,
but
I let the water out and that reduced my buoyancy.
Sure.
So I was, the water drained and then I thought, now I've got to get out of the tub, but I couldn't maneuver myself.
You were waterlogged.
Was Eric Dane filming you?
It was
Eric
hot.
Dane?
Let me tell you, me and the Mexicutioner were sudsing it up. No, so what? So I tried to wedge myself out of the tub.
Hold on. Hold on. Magic Johnson is going to yell, "Behold!"
Okay, I'm ready.
Here we go.
Behold, Great Pharaoh Ramsey, I bring to you the Stick Man.
There he is.
There you go.
Sorry.
Hello, Colonel Mahoney.
All right.
So I'm trying to get out of the tub. I realize I'm stuck in the tub, and I start calling for my husband to help me get out of the tub, but Michael Vick has just signed with the Eagles, so ESPN is on really loud.
He's torn.
He can't hear me. No, he just can't hear me.
Uh-huh.
So I'm yelling. It starts out like,
torn.
It's torn, dick. So should I help my pregnant, 7.5 months pregnant wife out of the tub, or do I watch this Michael Vick story? These are my beloved Eagles. So I try, with like, baby, and then I go to like, Daniel, and then now he can't hear me at all, and I can hear the ESPN, so I start banging on the back of the wall, and he finally comes in and gets me. So Michael Vick almost caused me to be stuck in there.
Well, I saw him on 60 Minutes, he was contrite, and I sort of appreciated that.
About Trudeau?
Yes.
He said he was sorry that his big news almost got me stuck in the tub.
And as I've said, whatever team got him, and it's the Eagles, I would line that guy up as the punter on every third down or every fourth down situation. Brian, I know your Brown noser, so please stay with me. Try not to disagree. I said if I had Michael,
with your head up his ass.
If I had Michael Vick on my team, I would go for it on just about every fourth down.
I totally agree.
Really, that was on what you know anywhere near the 50 and anywhere under 6 yards. I would just go for it, and it would confound the other teams. It would fuck them up, and I would have him. I would put him at quarterback, and I would do a direct snap, and I would tell him, "You just run left, and if you see an opening, go for it. And if not, go ahead and hit the tight end on the drag." And furthermore, I would line him up as a punter. He's an excellent athlete. You could teach the guy to punt, and you could certainly teach him to punt when he was in close.
Right.
No, he's not going to hit any boom. He's not going to hit any booming 70-yard punts. But him as a punter, nobody could drop back into the punt return. They'd always have to stay. All the linemen and everybody, And then what about the two guys you put on the outside?
Totally.
You have to put the two gunners on the outside. You can't put him there anymore. You just put him back as in a punt, and everyone has to stay frozen until he punts that ball, yeah, or he could run it. So I would be thinking of really innovative, cool ways and things to do
with
it.
I totally agree. Teams should punt less.
Right.
And if your average play goes for, what, 3 yards, 4 yards?
Right.
And fourth and short, go for it.
And if you have Michael Vick, and imagine how fucked up the other teams would be to see Michael Vick drop back to be the punter.
Imagine the pressure on a defense if you know you have to stop the team four times instead of
right.
three.
Absolutely. All
and
right.
Michael Vick did seem to admit that he had been kind of lazy as a player when he was talking to James Brown, and seemed like he was going to change his ways.
He was the last guy to every meeting and the first guy out.
Yeah.
Just like the Ace Man.
But he was contrite. I mean, we were complaining about people whose publicists don't tell them what to say.
Yeah.
This is the best coaching Michael Vick ever had.
Absolutely. He did it. It was funny, though, that they had to. Leslie Stahl couldn't have done the interview. They had to get a black guy from another network to come over and do it.
It took me the longest time. I'm like, what? Who? James Brown?
That's JB doing that.
Yeah.
And there is that thing. It's like a subtle sort of racism where it's like, don't put old establishment Whitey there. He doesn't want to see a guy in a sport coat with a Jim Blossom. He's going to freak out. Get a black guy. Let him sniff your hand.
Right.
Give him that special handshake you guys do. And then he'll open up to you.
Yeah.
By the way, James Brown kept trying, but really couldn't get him to say that he hated dogs.
I know.
He kept trying.
But here's the thing, too. 60 Minutes has four or five of arguably the best journalist reporters on the planet. You're doing a story, a national story, about a guy who was, you know, a criminal who went to jail. Okay. You couldn't send one of your guys?
Steve Croft couldn't
handle
it?
He's in Beirut right now on assignment. It's kind of condescending and kind of weird and kind of like, if Michael Vick requests a brother, that's weird. Oh. If CBS on their own decides, hey, we got to get this black guy from another show who, by the way, it's not like Jim Brown pops up or JB. It's not like he pops up on every second episode. It's not like, oh, now he's in Darfur talking to the doctors over there. He doesn't pop up anywhere, does he?
No, very rare.
So is that kind of racist and weird?
I thought it was strange.
I mean,
I
thought
confused.
He did a good job and stuff, but
did.
It was still like, whoa.
But now maybe just to make it not look so bad, they'll have to send him like to do a profile on Celine Dion.
Better yet, I say Leslie Stahl sits in on Inside the NFL.
Yes.
Well.
Oh, she'd be great.
And she's just sitting there and going, look, if you want to run Wildcat, you run Wildcat. But if you don't have the right personnel, you're going to get punched in the face. It's called smash mouth football.
She has to do a heart of the nose.
And she starts dropping back, and she's got the pointer laser thing. And it's like, look how lazy the mic backer is getting back into his hook zone. He was frozen. Stop it. He was frozen by the play action, and now the guy here is playing hog and stud, get no penetration because they're both frozen by the play action. Right. They don't get deep enough into their hook zone, and here comes a sharp
and
over the middle.
Academic.
Yes. That'd be awesome to see
and
Leslie
Stahl.
For
that, Leslie Stahl breaks out the leather jacket she sometimes wears.
Right.
She hips it up.
It'd be awesome, too, if she went over to that little patch of AstroTurf and go, let me explain how this works. You come out of your stance, chip the outside backer who's blitzing. You have to chip him. Chip him and then break into the flat. If you don't chip him, he's going to get a free shot at the quarterback. He's never going to get the ball to you. Right. She throws a forearm shiver to Brian Baldinger. It'd be awesome. All right, where were we?
Well, I just mentioned Celine Dion, and she's pregnant. The 41-year-old singer confirmed to various news outlets that she and Rene. Are expecting another baby.
That's French for creepy old bald guy.
Well, yeah, Rene Angelil is creepy old bald
Angelil
guy.
Creepy. They do that same stories that that's that kind of Elvis math you have to do. Well, she was 11 when they met, but of course, nothing went on until she was 12.
No.
Like what?
Just like that's not a sex tape.
Yeah, he was 61 and she was a zygote, and he took a shine into her mother's belly. And, he was a father figure. Yeah, of course, he was 35 years older than she was. He like discovered her when she was 14 or something.
But then they waited until she was of age.
I've never met a chick where I've went, I'm not really into you physically now. And then 5 years went, whoa, now I really want to screw you. It's actually the opposite. But I don't know why you're supposed to believe. And how old is this?
67.
He's 67. She's what?
41.
41. Okay. Yeah. So that's 81 years.
And they have 81 years apart. But they have been together a long time. They already have a son, René Charles.
And then when did they meet? That's the scary part. Now, he's 67,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
She's 41, so that's 26 years, right?
1975.
So what year did they meet is the question. And then if they met when she was 15, right?
The story goes that he was managing her,
sure.
And she was, I feel like, I don't know for sure, but I feel like she was quite a bit under the legal age.
Right.
Maybe
I mean,
in Canada is okay.
Yeah.
Maybe.
He was still probably, well, let's see there. 1994, third wife, Celine Dion.
He has 3 other kids from 2 previous marriages.
Oh, okay. 1974, second wife. But how old were they when they met? I don't know how old. That's what I was asking. Anyway, keep going. Sorry.
Well, as Donnie finds that piece of information, which I'm quite sure is going to creep us all out.
Yes.
They got pregnant with the help of at least what
Minnie
people...
Minnie McCready.
Oh, my God.
She wanted to make up for some of her sins. And she helped them out.
She's everywhere.
With a team of fertility specialists.
Apparently. Yeah, they did.
Yeah. So it required a team.
Steamy filmed them when they teamed her. Yeah.
And they're very excited. They're happy. You know, she comes from a big family. She is one of 14
Hasn't
kids.
Hasn't he already had a heart attack?
I believe he might have had some sort of cancer.
This is the problem with this, too, is they meet... Guys die, like, 8 years earlier anyway.
Right.
So what happens is you marry guys 40 years older, and plus he's going to die 8 years before you. She'll be 46. He'll be in the grave, and it's like the rest are... First time they met, she was 12, and he was 38.
Yes, 12 is... That is...
12 and 38 is weird, but... The weirder is the 14 and 40, which probably happened a few years later.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But again, their story is that the day, the minute she turned 18, then suddenly they saw each other with new eyes.
Just like Elvis was just talking to Priscilla upstairs.
Sure. Right, yeah.
Upstairs in the captain's house over there in Germany.
Well, they're over the moon about this new baby.
Mm-hmm.
And little René Charles... We'll have a
Don't
brother.
Don't they have one named
sister.
That already?
Yeah, René Charles will have a brother or sister.
Oh, I see.
No telling what the new one is going
to
be.
How many doctors constitute a team? When you start running a team?
It's a good question, but people does refer to it as
I gotta say more than beach volleyball and less than football.
Right. Somewhere in between there would be they conceived with the help of a team of fertility doctors in
That's
New York.
That's all I know.
Mm. Yeah. So congratulations to those two.
I wonder what the mascot would be.
Oh.
You know, for the team
fertility team.
Doctors?
Yeah, like
fertility doctors.
The zygotes?
I'd just go and grab one of those kielbasas they use in that race around the stadium every year. I feel like that's foul. Like,
right.
And already done. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah. Last story, T-Bone.
All right. I'll leave you with a Germany or Florida.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'll have to leave out some of the details. A bride spends her wedding night passed out next to a crate of vodka in the backseat of a car. She has to be rescued by police who fear that she's going to overheat in the sun. She's 30 years old. Now, after the cops smashed the window to get her out, she's still unconscious. Only after being shaken several times did she eventually regain consciousness, according to the police. She was still in her wedding dress, she was dazed, and she had to scramble through the broken window because she had no idea where the car keys or her husband were.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Feels very Floridian. Somehow the crate of vodka feels German to me. I don't know why.
Florida. With the heat.
The heat. Heat's a very good point. Though it does get hot in Germany in certain parts, right?
Sure. Very true.
Ah, it reeks of Florida. I'm going to go Germany only because they use the word crate for some reason.
This bride in Germany spent the night passed out next to a crate of vodka.
Damn.
I got to be 10 for 10, people.
That took place in Berlin.
More brown nose than from the B-man.
Berlin, Florida?
I'm sure there is one.
All right. So if you want to give to a very worthy cause, that would be our own Bald Brian. You can go to Hi Brian, B-R-Y-A-N.
Thank you for that.
And if you want to go to explodingmybaby.com.
That's right.
You can support our own Teresa Strasser. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Teresa Strasser and Bald Brian saying mahalo.
Follow Adam Carolla on Twitter at Adam Carolla. Reach him via Skype at Adam Podcast or through the mail at Adam Carolla Podcast, 10061 Riverside Drive, number 276, Toluca Lake, California, 91602. That's